morning. My name is Susan Reardon. I'm the staff hearing officer, and I call the meeting of Wednesday, April 17th to order. Today we have four items on our agenda, and I haven't received any requests for continuances or withdrawals, so I will hear them in the order that they appear on the agenda. Under announcements and appeals, I have received one appeal on a project located at 209 West Constant Avenue. It was approved with conditions by the staff hearing officer at the last meeting on April 3rd. A planning commission date hasn't been scheduled yet, and once one is scheduled, I will announce it. Is there anyone in the audience who would like to address the staff hearing officer on items not on today's agenda? Nope. Seeing no one. We'll go to the first item, which is 2020 Alameda Padre Sierra. Good morning.
Morning.
Or afternoon, actually. Yes. It's usually morning.
That's right.
Today we're starting later.
Is this on?
No, it's not on.
Just push this.
Push it and hold it.
Yeah.
All right. This 8.63 acre site is located in the Lower Riviera neighborhood and is part of the Riviera campus. The parcel is bounded by residential use to the north. Let's see here. Okay. To the north. Park use and residential use to the south. Commercial hotel use to the east and residential condominiums over here to the west. It's zoned SP7, which is the Riviera campus specific plan zone, is located in the Hillside Design District on a 12% average slope. It's a designated city landmark. The setbacks for the zone are 35 feet at the front yards facing APS and Alvarado Place and Mission Ridge Road, and at 25 foot at the interior property line. Site is currently developed with offices and a movie theater in seven buildings totaling roughly 69,000 square feet. Ebbets Hall, the project site is legal nonconforming as to the front setback. The proposed project involves increasing an existing 22-inch parapet wall, wall A, which is indicated in the green, by 20 inches, and increasing an existing 14-inch wall, wall B, indicated in yellow, by 28 inches, resulting in both walls to be 42 inches in height to safely surround these two rooftop decks and comply with current building code standards. Total length of the raised parapets is 82 linear feet, and the total area of the decks is 690 square feet. So also the staff report refers to the decks as existing, but the notice referred to them as proposed. The archive records aren't clear on the legal status of the roofs as decks. So in order to clarify this for the future, and taking into account that it was adequately noticed to the public as proposed, staff is requesting that the use of the rooftop decks be approved as part of this zoning modification. The project was reviewed by the Historic Landmarks Commission on February 13th and was continued to the staff hearing officer with positive comments. A zoning modification is being requested to raise the height of these parapets that are currently located within the 35-foot front setback. It's staff position that the proposed project is supportable because the vertical alteration is minor in nature and will not cause the footprint of the walls to further encroach into the setback. The impact on the appearance of the building will be minimal, and the alterations will enhance the use of the building by allowing the deck areas to be used by tenants in a safe and secure manner. Staff does not anticipate impacts to the adjacent parcel across Alvarado Place because the El Encanto Hotel's restaurant kitchen is, well, you can't see it. The hotel's restaurant kitchen is located in the new three-story building adjacent to the site, and it's not guest rooms. So it's just a wall with, and I do have windows. I mean, I do have pictures showing the windows. So staff requests approval of the project as proposed, making the findings that the modification is consistent with the purposes and intent of the zoning ordinance and is necessary to secure an appropriate improvement on the lot. And that concludes my presentation.
Okay, great, thanks. Mm-hmm. If you'd like to state your name for the record and provide additional comments.
My name is Richard Redman, Edwards and Pittman Architects, and that was very clear. I don't know much more I can add. We are going to have a structural engineer actually take a look at these decks to make sure that they are, especially in lieu of this problem that they had out at IV with the decks failing. So we're having an engineer actually this week or next week actually stick his head down below and make sure that all the structure is actually compatible with the use. So that's all I really have to add. The raising of the parapet should match exactly what's out there in stucco and so on and so forth. So I think our impetus initially was, since there was access out there by an existing door, to actually provide something that was safe that we knew the tenant might use. So that's kind of the way we approached it. And, of course, we have to kind of carry on from there to actually make them a real safe environment. So.
Okay. Yeah, that was my question, is looking at the pictures, and then I went out to the site and looked at the decks. They're doing the interior work now, and my question was, is this a legal deck now, just to make sure it's all safe?
We will certainly make sure that it is. Okay. It certainly complies with building permit requirements, and that would be up to the engineer, and I think he would even think about, you know, 100 pounds per square foot actually has a live load on there. That's pretty excessive, but but knowing decks in Santa Barbara is kind of critical.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Thank you. I'd like to open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who would like to address the staff hearing officer on this item, which is 2020 Alameda Padre Sierra? Seeing no one. Have we received any letters?
No.
Okay. So I'll close the public hearing. Like I said, I went out to the site, looked at the area. First with the thought of looking at the raised parapets, what that would do, and then secondly, in terms of the use of it as a deck.
Right.
Deck. And given its location, its zoning, again, the El Encanto across the street, its existing building area, you're not pumping out, you're going up minor, but there is higher buildings around. I think it is an appropriate use and an appropriate improvement, and I can make the findings that staff was proposing in the staff report. Let me just make sure it's clear that it has the deck included.
I wonder if we need to mention
that. Yeah, in terms of what the resolution will say, it will, in terms of the project description, it will include the one that was included in the notice so that it's very clear for future reference that it is the deck.
Okay.
And the increase in the height of the parapet walls.
Okay.
So it's a roof deck and not just a rooftop.
Right, yeah,
okay.
So it would be a roof deck.
Okay.
So it would be changing the use or adding the use in the setback.
Okay.
So with that, I will approve the project. The heading says findings and conditions. I don't see any conditions. I don't believe I need to add any conditions to your project, so it's approved as submitted. My action is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days, and they also have oversight authority of all my actions, and if they felt this warranted additional discussion before them, they would call it up during that same 10-day appeal period. And if that was to occur, the fans would contact you.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Sure. Thank you. The next project is 444 Canal Road. I'll stamp mine unless you want me to stamp this one.
I
right, so the project for today is 444 Kaneo Road. This is a T-fire rebuild. The original house was a one-story house and a one-car garage that both they did encroach into the front and interior setbacks. The applicant actually submitted and was issued a building permit in 2012 to rebuild within the setbacks, and in the process decided that given the parking constraints on the site to request a two-car garage, which necessitated the modification that's here before you today. So the modification includes the new extended encroachment because of the two-car garage, some minor window and door changes, and a change in the roof line. It's changing from a hip to a gable within the setbacks. So that's all going to be on the first floor. The second story that's proposed is all conforming to height and to setback requirements. This has been reviewed by the Single Family Design Board with positive comments. As I said, the encroachments are pretty minor given the constraints of the site because of the topography and size of the lot itself. So we support the modification, staff supports the modification because it's the constraints really make it a good idea to have a two-car garage because there really is no parking area. It's easy to access from the site.
Is it getting closer to the street?
It is. It's actually...
No.
If you look at the original, it's really not much closer.
Actually, it doesn't move. Because the parts...
You want to state your name for the record?
Yes, I'm sorry.
That's fine.
My name is Pezad Basuman. I'm the designer for 444 Kaneho Road.
The deck has also been pulled back a little bit. It's used to... approach a little bit further out, so it's actually a little bit of reduced. So, yeah, they've pulled the garage in. They've just enlarged the house by going up the second story, which does not encroach into the setback.
So the interior setback modification involves the building getting longer in this corner?
No.
Okay.
No, that doesn't change. The garage was already here. You're just just adding it a little bit this side.
Okay.
So it hasn't, doesn't move any of these,
walls. Okay, so what's the interior setback?
Interior setback is because of here, this is the setback.
This is the line of setback.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That's the line of setback. So, if the garage wall was here, now we are moving the garage wall was there. So I guess it's a little bit here, interior setback. And here, as they told me, is the change of use. Because there was a wall here, now the wall goes there.
Okay.
But it doesn't make any difference from outside.
Okay, it's so in terms of the volume of the building...
Nothing has changed.
Okay. So this length is the same. It's just the change of use from a building, from habitable space to the garage.
Exactly.
In the interior. And then the front setback is... windows, doors, roof changes,
exactly.
And then you are again changing a little bit of the use in the front setback.
Exactly.
Were you done with the presentation? Sorry, did you want to add anything more?
No, I think that's it. She did a good job representing me. But again, the garage, it was a one-car garage.
Mm-hmm.
It had so much problem. If the car was parked inside there, this had to back up to the street for the person to leave. And then when moved the garage, which was actually suggested to us by, SFDB to make it, then when we did that, the deck was bigger here. Then we had to move the deck a little bit toward inside, but we shortened it. So the new deck right now is actually a little bit smaller than what it was before. There was a stairs here that we took the stairs off. Then we had to move the door inside the house. Then when we moved the door, we had to push the bathroom a little bit inside and make the window coming. So everything kind of had, you know, to be adjusted a little bit.
The domino effect.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay. That was my question. I'd like to open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who would like to address the staff hearing officer on 444 Conejo Road?
Yes.
Come up and speak, and then if you could fill us. Kathy, do we have speaker slips?
Yeah.
Go come up and say your name. And then.
My name is Brian Milburn. I own the adjacent property on the south side. My wife and I have owned that for close to 40 years.
Well, you want to come sit down in the chair if you can. Speak into the mic. Should we turn it on? That's okay.
Yeah, my wife and I have owned the property next door for about 40 years. And I actually supported the project before. I still support the project. I think this is a much better idea. The way that the garage was configured before, it was virtually unusable unless you had a small car, and the slope of the driveway meant that you couldn't really park in the driveway, so it led to a lot of on-street parking. I think by actually having a garage that you can use, pull in, park your car, it makes a lot more sense, and it's going to result in, you know, the resident there being able to park his car as opposed to leaving it in the street. So,
and street parking for the day.
And street parking can be a problem there. So it's overall, we support it, and we continue to support it, and we think it's great.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thanks.
Is there anyone else who would like to address this staff hearing officer on this item? No, seeing no one. Did we receive any public letters or emails?
Right here.
Did you receive any?
No, I did not.
Okay. Okay. All right. Great. So I'll close the public hearing. I've been out to the site many times over the last couple of years since the T fire, and you know, it's nice to see people are actually being able to rebuild. And you know, the site's constrained by many factors: the size, the slope, even a narrow street, the dimensions. So it is a really constrained site. And the house you're proposing is, you know, it's not, it's pretty modest, 1,600 square feet. It's not like you're trying to develop it property line to property line. And, you know, given all the constraints in the proposed development, I think the use or the proposed modifications of changing the use and the setback and the minor exterior changes with the roof and the windows, they're all appropriate improvements and supportable. And with that, I can make the findings outlined in the staff report. Staff's not proposing any conditions, and I don't believe I need to add any conditions. So I approve your project. My action is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days, and they also have oversight authority of all my actions. If they felt this warranted additional discussion before them, they could call it up during that same 10-day appeal period. And if that was to occur, Betsy would contact you. Okay?
Thank you very much.
Sure. The next item is 3554 State Street, if the applicant would like to come up.
I have pages that are corrections, and the owner didn't get them into me till last night, so they're just replacing the what they requested was the project description, so that's the change on page one. And page two, they had wanted an elevation actually showing the dome awning. Also, they wanted to replace this dome is really not representative of the dome awning that's going to be used, so I've replaced that.
Okay. Good.
Suzanne, I'll make my presentation first.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. This is a project at 3554 State Street. The proposal is to install three new awnings for an existing business on State Street. The existing building is nonconforming to the SB2 setback for one-story buildings, which is 10 feet. It encroaches approximately 5 feet already into that required setback. The proposed awnings will encroach up to an additional 4 feet 8 inches, leaving about 4 inches to the property line. The aerial photograph that you have there demonstrates the pattern of development along the north side of State Street, where the buildings are built closer to the street and do not observe that SD2 setback. The SD2 setback was created in about 1972. It was a setback that was created to help control traffic in the area, allow for bigger setbacks from the street, more visual openness. However, the SD2 guidelines, which I believe the hearing officer has a copy of, allow for similar type encroachments, such as these awnings that don't add floor area to encroach into the SD2 setback. The applicant is requesting them to shield the windows from sun and enhance the streetscape of the property. Staff is supportive of the requested modification. The ABR also reviewed the project on March 11th and found that the awnings as proposed were acceptable. They just wanted to make sure that all the awnings, the bottom of all the awnings, aligned. There was some variation originally, and these drawings do reflect that change. With that, I believe it's an appropriate improvement for the business and recommend approval.
Great, thank you. I'd like to say your name for the record.
Yes, Lori Vividson, and I'm an agent for the TI owner, which is Shonda Fetter, and that's IM equals X Pilates Studio.
Okay. And then you were saying you had some changes, or are these, this represents
this? Okay. Yeah. That change, the project description, originally they were going to also do a deck in the back, and so we had that removed from the project description. She decided not to do that.
Okay.
And then, let's see how these, they, the awning company just sent me like a representation of how they build them.
Mm-hmm.
So, I've already got these, but I redid your sheets to show that change.
Anything more you would like to add, or is that?
Nope, she said it very well.
Okay, great.
I think it's going to be a good improvement for the property. Okay. I don't show the awning that's already existing at Bices and Spices, but they kind of all align.
Great, thank you. I'd like to open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who would like to address the staff hearing officer on this item? Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. I went out to the site. And you know, to the site, I also had a similar project last month and the month before for awnings a little bit farther down State Street.
Is that for the bar?
Uptown Lounge, yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
uh-huh.
Saw a similar thing. And there is, you know, some buildings up there have them, some don't. I believe that in this instance it is a necessary and appropriate improvement. It doesn't encroach into the public right-of-way. Mm-hmm. It doesn't increase the building area. So I think it is an appropriate improvement for this building and can support the front yard modification. So with that, I'll make the findings outlined in the staff report and approve the project. And staff's not proposing any conditions, and I don't believe I need to add any conditions. But my action is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days, and they also have oversight authority of all my actions.
Mm-hmm.
And if they felt this warranted additional discussion before them, they would call it up during that same 10-day appeal period. And if that was to occur, Suzanne would contact you.
Okay.
Just as an advisory note, that the signage that you're showing on the awnings will not be a part of the permit, and you'll need to make a note that that is not a part of the awning permit.
Okay.
So that would be separate. It's a separate sign permit.
Right, okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
If you can leave me one set of what you showed. Here's one sheet, but you said there was changes.
Was there four sets, I think, that were submitted? So I made copies for all those two. Okay, should I leave those with you as well?
I just need one right now, I think.
I'll just stamp one.
Okay.
Yeah.
If you just leave me a cover sheet, then I'll be with that.
And the other one would be used for design review follow-up.
Yeah. Yeah, then you can submit. ADR off the counter.
Okay.
With the original. I have one of each.
You do? Okay. Good.
Can I see these? This is the first little. Just look my records up.
Thank you. And I think, do I leave this with you?
No, you're going to take those to the camera.
Okay.
The last project's 1440 West Valerio Street, if the applicant would like to come up. West Valerio. The proposal involves permitting an as-built approximately 45 square foot bathroom addition at the rear of the house, which encroaches into their existing non-conforming open yard. So the discretionary application before the show today is a modification to the open yard location and configuration requirements. A little bit of background on this particular property was that this residence, the original residence, was approximately in this location, was constructed in 1935 as part of a subdivision. And then in 1940, the porte cochere that was located here was enclosed to create a new bedroom. Later, there was an addition for that garage, and I'm sorry, I don't have the date of when that garage occurred. The current property owner purchased the property in September of 2011. The zoning information report that was prepared at the time of the sale noted that the bathroom had been added without the benefit of a permit. In April 2012, the owner submitted a building permit application to legalize the as-built bathroom addition, and it was determined that it was reducing the largest and most conforming portion of the open yard under the current rules. He submitted his application for the modification in early February. Immediately afterwards, we received a complaint about the fence that was constructed along the front property line and some hedges that were overgrown along the side. And I will show you a picture of the hedges. Probably had it on top.
Or this one here.
That is the picture I was looking for. Sorry. I then worked with the applicant to have him demonstrate on the proposal that the hedges will be reduced 20 feet back from the existing property line to a maximum height of 3.5 feet to be consistent with the code. That also meant that some of the hedge that is occurring in the right-of-way would have to be removed. The fence along the front property line currently, or within the right-of-way, currently exceeds a maximum height of 3.5 feet. The applicant has been advised that a public works encroachment permit will be necessary in order to maintain that fence. He has had some preliminary discussions with the public works staff. Subsequent to that, I have spoken to the supervising transportation engineer about the location of the fence and its relationship to visibility, and will be requesting that you slightly revise the condition of approval listed in the staff report to include that the supervising transportation engineer is consulted prior to issuance of the public works encroachment permit. There may need to be some further refinement of the fence location and height for visibility issues. As I've outlined on the plans, the area that is highlighted in green results in an area that is 1,260 square feet. It does not conform to the minimum dimension of 20 feet. The smallest portion has a dimension of 12.5 feet, but staff feels this is the most usable conforming location for open yard that would allow the bathroom addition to remain. With that, staff recommends approval of the modification to reduce the non-conforming, or to alter the location of the open yard to a conforming amount
with a non-conforming dimension of 12 and a half feet as a minimum, and subject to the conditions that are listed in the staff report.
Okay.
With the one amendment that I discussed.
Do you have writing for it or no? I'm just going to add it in.
I'm just going to add it in.
Okay. Oh, great, thanks. Would you like to state your name for the record and add any additional comments?
Yes, Ramiro Arroyo, and the hedge has been cut already, so it's 30 feet back from the curb, so it'd be 20 feet back from the property line. So that's been addressed, and I just didn't have a chance to take any pictures and bring them, but there's definitely visibility now coming up Valerio Street. And like Suzanne said, I'm working with Public Works to get the permit on the encroachment of the fence and within the right of way. So whatever it takes to address that issue. So I'm still working with it.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who would like to address the staff hearing officer on this item? No. Seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing. I did go out to the site and looked at the area. In regards to the requested open yard modification and the encroachment of the building, what it is, like 80, how much was it? 45 square feet. I believe that's a minor encroachment, and given the layout of the property and the layout of the open areas, the patio in the back, and the open yard areas, I think there is adequate open yard area, although your site is small, but it's R1, right?
Correct. Mm-hmm.
5,600 square feet. There is adequate areas. What made you denote here versus over in this area, Suzanne, as part of there?
Based on how the property is currently being used and functions, the homeowner is using that front area as their primary outdoor living space.
Okay.
It was a larger area than at the rear. We did want to allow them some opportunity, you know, if they wanted to put a patio cover or something in the future that wouldn't trigger the need for them to come back for a secondary modification.
Okay. All right, great. Thanks. My question's related actually to one, in regards to the fence, I understand that the fence is on the right-of-way, in the right-of-way, so it's not subject to a modification. But when I went out to the site, I was concerned regarding the visibility of people coming down the street here and seeing that way. So I'm glad to hear that revising the condition to have the transportation staff look at it, just to make sure that they're integrated with the encroachment permit and that we're not causing any.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah, that's fine. It's actually really interesting the way that the property's set up. If you look at Valerio Street itself, the way it seems like the property, because it's a corner, it sweeps so wide. The stop sign that's on Calle Poniente is actually offset a little bit. And if people actually stopped on that street, they would be able to see both ways, but most people don't really stop because they're in a hurry, I guess. But you know, it's been like that for many years, and I come in and, you know, make changes to the property, and I've gotten very positive feedback about it, and you know, it just, some people aren't very happy with what I've done, I guess. But it's driving down that street, you know, to me, at least, it seems like there's plenty of visibility.
Yeah, we'll have the transportation engineer,
supervising transportation engineer, review the final design of the fence.
Absolutely.
So then, in regards to the condition, it sounds like you're going to pursue the option of the public right, the public encroachment permit.
I would. Yes, that's what I'm going to. I plan on doing that just because, you know, I do use the front yard as my primary living space, as Suzanne mentioned. And, you know, if you can see here, there is an existing cedar that is well-established and probably in its full stage. And it's off the property line. It's so close to the property line that it would, I mean, it's just, there's really it would leave us no room to really do much. I mean, the side yard, it pinches, and, you know, you try to do what you can with the space, but, you know, given the location of the fence, it's it does wonders for the family.
So, okay. Yeah. Well, I just want to alter condition three. Though it sounds like that you're not pursuing that, but if in the future it is, just to say, it says, prior to the issuance of a building permit, the wood fence that has been constructed in the public right-of-way shall either be shown on the plans to be relocated onto the private property, and I want to add, and brought into conformance with Santa Barbara Municipal Code 2887-170, which is the fence height one.
Okay.
And then leave the other one, or the property owner shall submit a separate application for encroachment and then add the word permit to allow the fence to remain. So just to clarify, okay. If it is relocated, it needs to comply.
Sure, absolutely.
With that section.
Yeah, definitely.
And then when I was out there, I noticed there's a lot of stuff stored on the site, like in the setbacks. And I don't know if it's there's not any construction here, but there's
plus it was landscaping.
Yeah, so the stuff that's stored in the setbacks, open yard like here.
Yeah, that's removed. That's no longer there. This has been totally cleaned up. Yeah, I just,
okay.
You know, I just moving in.
Right,
it's been, it's been tough. But all that's gone. So,
well, I was just gonna put a condition, and then when the inspector goes out there, he'll just sign it.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Yeah. And so I did my due diligence with it. So okay. I cleaned it up. It needed it anyway. So everything in the back has been cleaned up. All this. Tile has been moved. All the wood's been relocated. The stone pile's still there just because it's not easy to move around. But other than that, it's going to be used within the house and landscape and stuff.
Okay. So I'll just put a condition that it shall be removed from the setbacks and open yard area. And since it's done, it'll just go check
okay.
It out.
Wonderful.
And then there was a ZIR that was done in it, and that listed violations, which, you know, you've removed
correct.
The carport. Mm-hmm. I guess there was a shed.
Which is now here.
And garage. I'm just going to put a condition that abate the zoning and building violations listed in that ZIR. It included some improvements in the garage. And again, many of them have been done, so it'll just be signed off.
Okay.
It's just when they're not, items aren't put for immediate enforcement, the next application that comes in, you're supposed to clean up the site. So
okay.
Just to make it a clear record.
Sure.
That's all. Cleaned up and everything.
That's wonderful. Yeah.
Suzanne, speaking to the conditions, condition two spoke about reducing the height to 3.5 feet. So I don't know if you're adding that other provision in condition three, whether condition two is entirely necessary.
Well, I don't think it hurts. If I was going to change it to, well, when I was reading the report, I wasn't sure which way you were going, so I was proposing to change it. If the wood fence that has been constructed in the public right-of-way receives an encroachment permit, then it shall be reduced to a maximum height of 3.5 feet.
Okay.
Yeah. So that way it covers any option.
Sure. No, that's fine. That's I mean, 3.5 feet is what needs to be anyway, so that's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, okay, so with those revised and added conditions, I can make the finding outlined in the staff report and approve your project. My action is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days,
okay.
And they also have oversight authority of all my actions, and if they felt this warranted additional discussion before them, they could call it up during that same 10-day appeal period, and if that was to occur, Suzanne would contact you.
Okay.
Okay?
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I adjourn the meeting. Thank you.